No, I still go back to the choice that you have to make in the kind of society that you live in.
Well, there's a lot of bleeding hearts around who just don't like to see people with helmets and guns. All I can say is go on and bleed. But it's more important to keep law and order in this society than to be worried about weak-kneed people who don't like the looks of a soldier.
At any cost? At any cost? How far would you go with that? How far would you extend that?
Just watch me.
At reducing civil liberties? To that extent?
To what extent?
Well, if you extend this and you say, okay, you're going to do anything to protect them, this include wiretapping, reducing other civil liberties in some ways?
Yes, I think the society must take every means at its disposal to defend itself against the emergence of a parallel power which defies the elected power in this country. And I think that goes to any distance. So long as there is a power in here which is challenging the elected representative of the people, I think that power must be stopped. And I think it's only, I repeat, weak-kneed, bleeding hearts who are afraid to take these measures.
Weak-kneed, bleeding hearts who are afraid to take these measures. That, ladies and gentlemen, is Pierre Elliott Trudeau, the father of Justin Trudeau, who back in the 70s had just enacted the War Measures Act, which is now known as the Emergencies Act. Here it is, folks. And right now, today, it just so happens to be trending on Twitter. We see Emergency Measures Act and Emergencies Act now trending on Twitter because just today, Trudeau announced they may now have new emergency measures under consideration. So this has a lot of people talking about what he potentially means when it comes to enacting this act, which is why it's trending on Twitter. But today I want to bring to your attention another act that I think is of the utmost importance that's largely going under the radar and completely missed by everyone. This is what should be trending here instead of Emergencies Act is this one, ladies and gentlemen, the Quarantine Act, which achieved royal descent back in 2005 following the SARS outbreak. And this is the one that would give the Canadian government the ability to enact all-out martial law and to completely obliterate the rights of Canadian citizens. So in this video, we're going to be taking a close look at just what kind of things the Quarantine Act is going to give the Canadian government the ability to do to you and me under this COVID-19 pandemic. But just before we do, guys, I'd ask that you check us out here at pressfortruth.ca/donate. We really need your help in this effort to bring you this information. There's a massive disinformation campaign going on out there. A great deal of fear and panic has set upon the people of the world. Countries all over the place are panicking, and we want to bring you the alternative sources of information that you're not getting from the mainstream when it comes to this pandemic. So if you appreciate our efforts to do so, please check the links right here on the screen or in the description below to find out how you can contribute to our efforts to bring you guys this very important information. All right, so this just out from CTV News, new emergency measures are under consideration, and this was just announced by the Prime Minister this morning. Prime Minister Justin Trudeau is looking into recalling Parliament for a brief period in order to pass additional legislative measures, such as changes to employment insurance and potentially even enacting some aspects of the Federal Emergencies Act as Canada continues to ratchet up its response to COVID-19. It goes on to say here, the federal government invoking the Emergencies Act, formerly known as the War Measures Act, and declaring a national public emergency would grant them considerable powers to lead the nationwide response, including the restriction on the movements of goods and people within Canada. Doing so would require parliamentary oversight, meaning a small number of politicians would have to reconvene in Ottawa in the coming days. There are economic pieces that will need quick passage in order to support Canadians, Trudeau said. And we are also examining the Emergency Measures Act to see if it is necessary or if there are other ways that will enable us to take the actions needed to protect people. For now, Trudeau said that his officials are exploring whether it's possible to activate certain emergency protocols or to take additional safety precautions without having to go as far as declaring a state of emergency. Ministers are reaching out to all premiers about this move as it requires their consultation. The last time these federal emergency powers were invoked was during the 1970 FLQ October crisis when Trudeau's father was the prime minister. We are very aware that the Emergencies Act is a measure of last resort which does grant extraordinary powers to the federal government, said Deputy Prime Minister Chrystia Freeland. And of course, we've already seen some of these drastic measures being enacted in the last few days with Trudeau announcing the travel ban of any non-Canadian residents, with the exception of Americans, into Canada. And that was done under the Emergencies Act. But again, one of the bigger problems here, and one of the bigger things that I think people are missing in regards to what may potentially be coming down the road for Canadians, as I said, is not so much the Emergencies Act of 1985, but the Quarantine Act, which is actually introduced in the 1800s, and it was laid dormant for over 100 years. Nothing was done with this until the SARS outbreak, and this was amended back in 2005 and achieved a royal assent. So we're going to go through this one today, guys, just to show you just how crazy things are getting. In the beginning, they go through the various definitions of what we're going to be discussing. But let's just get into the powers that are granted to the minister here. Designating analysts and certain officers they have to put into place, designating quarantine officers, review officers, certificates are to be produced, quarantine stations. The minister may establish a quarantine station at any place in Canada. The operator of a facility in which a customs office within the meaning of Section 2 of the Customs Act is located shall, when required in writing by the minister, provide and maintain free of charge any area or facility, along with its fixtures, that the minister considers necessary for establishing a quarantine station. Ladies and gentlemen, this is essentially saying that they can determine any place to be a quarantine facility. A private home, a business, a residence, a gym, a library, you name it, they can turn any physical building into a quarantine zone, and you have no say about it. Any person in charge of a place shall, at the request of the minister, provide that place to the minister. If, in the opinion of the minister, the temporary use of this place as a quarantine facility is necessary to protect the public health. So you have no say in the matter. If they come along and say, we need to use your house or this particular facility that you are in possession of, we're taking it and we're doing it for the better of the people. The minister may compensate any person for the minister's use of this place. Interesting word here, may compensate any person for the use of the place. The minister shall consult with the provincial public health authority of the province in which the place is situated before taking possession of it. And then we get on to some of the more troubling aspects of how they're going to potentially deal with travelers who they feel may be infected. The obligation on arriving travelers, every person who's subject to Section 1 of the Customs Act and enters Canada shall immediately after entering present themselves to a screening officer at the nearest entry point. Now, a lot of these things are already being implemented, but then we get into this, some of the more sinister. If a traveler refuses to be screened with the screening technology and the person using it is not a screening officer or a quarantining officer, the person shall immediately inform a screening officer or quarantine officer of the refusal. And we see here, there's a duty to provide information, there's a duty to disclose the communicable disease. You have to comply with these measures. The officers have an obligation to inform you of certain things, but here we go. Isolation. The screening officer may, without directives from a quarantine officer, isolate the traveler individually or within a group until the traveler is assessed by a quarantine officer. The traveler may be informed, a screening officer or quarantine officer who takes any action in respect to a traveler under this act shall, if reasonably possible, inform the traveler of the measures being taken. And look at this, guys, under Section 18, arrest without warrant. A peace officer may, at the request of a screening officer or quarantine officer, arrest without warrant and bring to a quarantine officer any traveler who the peace officer has reasonably grounds to believe has refused to be isolated or refuses to comply with the measure under Section 15.3. So anyone under the direction of an officer can be arrested without warrant simply for refusing to be isolated or refusing to comply with any of the measures under Section 15.3. Guys, this is exactly some of the things we're starting to see in Italy, for example. I reported on this just yesterday. Italians are getting arrested and face 3 months in jail for violating a new decree. So we're already seeing these types of things happen in other countries, and we already have the act in place here in Canada to do the exact same things. Health assessment requirement. A quarantine officer may require a traveler to undergo a health assessment if the officer has reasonable grounds to suspect that the traveler has or might have a communicable disease or is infested with vectors or has recently been in close proximity to a person who has or might have a communicable disease or is infested with vectors. The traveler has refused to be screened under Section 14, or the traveler has contravened subsection 15, 1, or 3. And then it gets on where it says you're essentially going to be forced to undergo medical treatment. When health assessments are to be undertaken, the health assessment shall be undertaken as soon as reasonably practical, but in any case, within 48 hours after the quarantine officer requires the traveler to undergo it. They're going to disinfect the traveler, disinfestation of the baggage, disinfestation of a place. A quarantine officer or person acting on their behalf may enter and disinfect any place at any entry or departure point if a traveler or baggage that was or may be disinfected under Section 2 has been in or that place, and the quarantine officer has reasonable grounds to believe that the place is infested with vectors. Medical examination. If a quarantine officer has reasonable grounds to believe that a traveler has or might have a communicable disease or is infested with vectors or has recently been in close proximity to a person who has or might have been communicable disease or infested with vectors, the officer may require the traveler to undergo a medical examination. Again, you know, it sounds not so bad when they use the words may require, but as you'll soon see a little later in the document, we're going to find out that they're actually going to be completely forced to do so. As we see down here, if a quarantine officer, after the health assessment of a medical examination of a traveler, has reasonable grounds to suspect that the traveler might have a communicable disease, yada, 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 but is of the opinion that the traveler does not pose an immediate risk of significant harm or health, the officer may order the traveler to report to the public health authority specified in the order. The quarantine officer shall, without delay, send a copy of an order made to Section 1 to the public health authority specific in the order. And here we go, order to comply with treatment. If a quarantine officer, after the medical examination of a traveler, has reasonable grounds to believe that the traveler has or might have a communicable disease or is infested with vectors or has been in close proximity to a person who might have the disease or with the vectors, the quarantine officer may order the traveler to comply with treatment or any measures for preventing the introduction and spread of the communicable disease. The quarantining officer may order the traveler to comply with the treatment of any and other measures of preventing the introduction and spread of communicable diseases. Guys, now we're venturing into mandatory vaccination language. Now we're talking into the forced medication of a society. This is precisely what I got into with Del Bigtree when we spoke on coronavirus and the coming mandatory vaccination program. I'm going to include a link to that video in the description below, guys. If you haven't seen it, I would strongly suggest you check it out, because in that video, we lay out the very real possibilities of that happening. And as I've just showed you, the Canadian government quite literally has this in the act that they can do so if they choose to go this route. Arrest warrant. On an application by quarantine officer or provincial court judge within the meaning of Section 2 of the Criminal Code who is satisfied on information submitted in writing or under oath that a traveler has failed to comply with an order made under subsection 25.1 or Section 26 may issue a warrant directing a peace officer to arrest the traveler and take them to a quarantine officer. Detention by a quarantine officer. A quarantine officer may detain any traveler who has refused to be disinfected or to undergo a health assessment, who is required to undergo a medical examination, who's failed to comply with an order under Section 26, the quarantine officer has reasonable grounds to believe that he might have a communicable disease or infested with vectors, is capable of affecting others, has been arrested under Section 27, or has been arrested without a warrant under Section 18. And again, they reiterate, a peace officer may, at the request of a quarantine officer, arrest without warrant and bring to the quarantine officer any traveler referenced to in subsection 1 who refuses detention. Here, at least, they say the quarantine officer shall provide the traveler with the opportunity to undergo a medical examination by a medical practitioner at least every 7 days after the day on which the detention begins. So if you know you're healthy and they're just holding you in quarantine, at least every 7 days you can go, look, I want to be tested again. You're going to have to show that I'm either negative or positive if you're going to want to continue to hold me in here. Gets on here, we got court order for medical intervention. Again, we're venturing into forced mandatory vaccination territory. A judge may make an order under this section only if the judge is satisfied that the order is appropriate to prevent or control a risk of significant harm to public health and other reasonable means are not available to prevent or control the risk. So this is incredibly troubling, guys. And this section here is also troubling to me. It gets into conveyances, and we're talking about the transporting of information, but also physical people. This section applies to the operation of any of the following conveyances: a conveyance that is used in a business or carrying persons or cargo, and a prescribed conveyance. An operator is to inform a quarantine officer before arrival, as soon as possible, before a conveyance arrives at its destination. The operator shall inform a quarantine officer or cause a quarantine officer to be informed of any reasonable grounds to suspect that any person or cargo or any other thing on board the conveyance could cause the spreading of a communicable disease listed in the schedule. A person on board the conveyance has died or any prescribed circumstances exists. So, long story short, this is essentially giving them the ability to stop anyone in the free flow, in their vehicles, anywhere essentially, traveling, and can take control of the vehicle and all the occupants inside. Communication of information to passengers. A person engaged in the business of carrying persons or cargo shall, at the request of a screening officer, a quarantine officer, or environmental health officer, communicate or distribute the traveler's information or questionnaires provided by the officer. There is no more, am I being detained? Am I free to go? You know, I'm not answering any questions. Well, no. If you are traveling with more than just yourself, you can be stopped and indeed questioned and potentially detained, and to have all your things stolen from you, essentially. And this, you know, it goes on. This is the 47-odd page act. I'm going to include this in the description so you guys could check it out for yourself. But they even talk about body parts and transporting human remains. Any operator of carrying a cadaver, a body part, or other human remains into Canada shall provide a copy of the death certificate to the screening officer at entry point. If there's no death certificate, if an operator does not provide a death certificate or a screening officer has reasonable grounds to suspect that the cadaver, body part, or other human remains have or might have a communicable disease or infested with vectors, the screening officer shall immediately inform a quarantine officer and follow any directive that this officer, respecting the matter. The directive, the operator shall comply with any directive of the quarantine officer respecting the cadaver, body part, or other human remains. So again, guys, we get into the general powers. A quarantine officer or an environmental health officer may, to determine whether a convenience or a place or any contents within it could be the source of a communicable disease, or whether a traveler has or might have a communicable disease or infested with vectors, and to enforce this act, they can stop it at any entry point anywhere else in Canada and direct that it be moved to a place where an inspection can be carried out. They can enter and inspect the conveyance or any place where the conveyance has been, guys. Open and examine any cargo, baggage, packages, or any other thing. require any person to produce any record under any terms and conditions that in the opinion of the officers are necessary to carry out the inspection. Guys, Canadian rights are going to be completely obliterated under this act. Except with respect to the traveler, conduct or cause to be conducted any tests or analysis or take or cause to be taken any sample, and except with respect to the traveler, take any measurements. Operations of data processing systems and copying equipment goes on with the powers of the screening officer. The screening officer may exercise any of these powers set out in this section other than those in paragraph 1E. Warrant and required to enter dwelling places. Well, here we see at least a quarantine officer and an environmental health officer may not enter or inspect a dwelling place without the consent of its occupant, except under the authority of a warrant, which, as we saw earlier, is not going to be too difficult for them to get when it comes to dealing with this pandemic. Use of force. A quarantine officer or environmental health officer who executes a warrant shall not use force unless they are accompanied by a peace officer and the use of force is specifically authorized in the warrant. So we're literally talking about physically being removed should you not comply, and they have the absolute ability to do this to anyone. Regardless of even if you're showing symptoms, regardless of whether or not you are complying or not, they can just do this to everybody if they choose to carry out the things that were in this act that received royal assent back in 2005 following the SARS outbreak. Again, I'll put a link to all of this in the description below, so you can see it all for yourself. But guys, in a nutshell, this quarantine act is not looking good. It's going to be given the government the ability to track your movements, to stop you, to use your own home or place of business as a quarantining facility. And some would argue that this goes against the charter. This goes against basic fundamental rights and freedoms. Obviously, there's a fine line and a balance that needs to be met here when it comes to protecting people and public health and safety and obliterating the rights of the citizens of that country. And like we said, that's why this journalist asked the then Prime Minister, Pierre Elliott Trudeau, just how far are you willing to go when it comes to this? Are we going to see martial law? Are we going to see troops on the streets here? That's when he famously said, just watch me. Just watch me. Well, now, today, ladies and gentlemen, his son is running the show. His son is in charge of the game. He's already said he's going to be looking at the things that his father did with the Emergency Measures Act. But as I warned today, I think the Quarantine Act is something that really ought to be trending on Twitter today, because as I've laid out in today's video, this is the one that gives the Canadian government the power to completely obliterate the rights of regular, everyday, average Canadian citizens, whether regardless if they're showing any symptoms or not. So this is something I just wanted to bring to your attention today, guys. Please check out the links in the description below. Do your due diligence. Read the Emergencies Act. Read the Quarantine Act. And get a good understanding of what they want to do moving forward, and at the same time, you know, think about what you're going to want to do, you know, to protect yourself and your family. Obviously, there's a lot of panic buying going on right now. I certainly wouldn't recommend anybody engage in any of that kind of activity, but that's not to say it's not wise to be prepared. Obviously, having storable food, emergency kits, and lots of water is certainly not a bad idea, especially when we're now leading to the very real possibility of the federal government declaring a nationwide emergency, just as the province of Ontario has just done, and enacting the Quarantine Act and carrying out everything that they can do in the Emergencies Act. So this is of the utmost importance for Canadians to understand moving forward. Guys, please share this video. Click the thumbs up button and let people know that there are some more sinister things at play here that are happening behind the scenes. We're potentially dealing with martial law in this country, and Canadians need to be aware that this is in fact taking place. So please click the thumbs up button, share this video with your friends and family, get this information out there. And once again, I'd ask that if you appreciate my efforts to bring this information to the table, please consider checking the links on the screen to pressfortruth.ca/donate. Here you can contribute a one-time donation with PayPal. You can join as a member. You can join as a PFD patron by clicking on this banner right here. You can contribute Bitcoin or other cryptocurrencies, or you can use the Patreon alternative right here and sign up for a monthly reoccurring amount to help us continue to bring you this information that you're simply not getting from the mainstream. So that's all for today, guys. I want to thank you all so much for tuning in. Once again, please click the thumbs up button, leave a comment, share this video. It really does help with the algorithms that are designed to stop this type of info from being seen. And other than that, that's all for today, guys. I want to thank you so much for tuning in. Stay tuned. We're going to have more video reports coming soon. This is Dan Dix reporting for Press for Truth. We all want truth. The truth will set you free.